blessing to be here.
Thank God. We give praise to God and to His Son and to the Holy Spirit. We thank Him for this opportunity to be here. We're glad that He blessed us and kept us. I hope that everybody's had a great day. I presume that you have because you're here.
Okay.
That's always a great indicator that you've had a great day and that you were able to walk in. We didn't have nobody. I don't see any in the wheelchair. They're still where they were supposed to be. So the fact that you walked in is an indication that you're doing great. As we let people kind of come in, I want to repeat myself. I'm going to go ahead and tell you what's going on. Because we're going to finish this tonight. We will. I got a few buildings left. We're going to finish this tonight. And we're going to have an open forum if so desired for questions or whatever. And then on next week, I sit down today with the coordinators of hospice, and we sit down and we fixed up a schedule. I wanted to make sure that when these people come, that they'll have somebody to talk to. And so what's going to transpire is that I'm going to extend the Bible study from 6 o'clock to 7:30 because I'm going to have both people, so they won't have to have two different sessions with them coming. Both of them will come. We will have the director of the chaplain and the bereavement service, Mr. Stacy Sanders, and we will have Ms. Mourning Elkins, community educator and volunteer coordinator for hospice in East Texas. And they will come out and they will set up tables with information, and they will do their presentation, and they will be open for any questions, any situations. And I also inform them that there are probably some people that might want to talk to them privately that might want to get, because don't be surprised by that, because a lot of people are just kind of a little skittish about, you know, talking or whatever, and they don't want anybody to know their business, and we respect that. And so that's what's going to happen on May the 4th. They will come out on May the 4th and do their presentation, and that will be officially end our series on bereavement, mourning, and bereavement. So that's how that's going to go down. And then our next study will pick back up in Revelation, but I'm going to start a series. My next series is going to be on discipleship, because one thing all churches need is a commitment from their people.
Amen.
Membership is good and fellowship is great, but what really grows the church is discipleship. And so that's what I'm looking to do, is to grow us. Okay. And so, all right, with that being said, we're going to go back into our studies today. Brother Calvin, if you hit those buttons, I think we were. Go ahead and hit those buttons, and I'll tell you to stop. Okay, go ahead. We were talking about the sorrow of the following may be seen in persons who are grieving. Okay, hold on. We talked about losing. Okay, go ahead. Trouble sleeping. Feeling tired. We talked about that. We stopped by right here, becoming preoccupied with death. You know, when people are mourning, they become obsessed, preoccupied with the events of death and death itself. Now, let me say this about death. And this is going to kind of sound a little crazy. It may even sound a little awful to you. But really, death for the Christian, and I'm talking about the Christian, let me qualify my statement, and I'm not talking about everybody. I'm talking about people that are believers who've been saved and been born again. Death for the Christian is no longer an enemy. Uh-huh. It's no longer an enemy. It used to be our enemy before Christ came and saved us. Death was our enemy. Death used to have a lot of power and a lot of sting. But Jesus took the power and the sting away from death. Right? He said, "O grave, where is thy victory? O death, where is thy sting?" And so death is a friend to those who are in Christ, because Paul said to live is Christ, uh-huh, and to die is gain. So Paul said, no matter whether we live in Christ, we're in good shape. If we die in Christ, we're in good shape. And then Revelation said, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord, henceforth through their labor follow. Right? So I just want you to know that we don't have to, I don't walk around worried about dying. You know, I'm not, every time I get in the car, I'm worried about somebody running into me. I'm not, you know, and you said that, but you'd be surprised how many people don't move, don't want to do anything, because they're preoccupied with dying. Let me tell you, wherever the Lord want to get you, no matter you be standing still, you be in a cage in your house. If the Lord wants you, He can come get you.
Amen.
He don't even have to have a key to the cage you're in. He can unlock the door, but just a mere fact, He said, door open and the door locked on. So I'm not preoccupied. Now, I am a little nervous about maybe riding a plane, you know, some of these, but I'm not so preoccupied that I won't get on one. Mm-hmm. I'm a little jitterish, but I've come to the conclusion that if he wants me in the sky or if he wants me on land, it ain't gonna really matter. So if I don't never fly, that ain't gonna care. Now, if I thought flying wasn't gonna, I could stay away from death, I would never get on a plane.
Wow.
I would stay at the house every day, right? Mm-hmm. But he can get me wherever, because it is appointed unto us all to die, right? And then comes the
judgment.
So a lot of times when people are dealing with grief, they're preoccupied. Now, let me tell you something. There are some people, I call them funeral home hunters. y'all already know where I'm going. There are some people that call Mr. Francis every day. Trying to say, whose body do you have? Yeah. Listen, it's some people right here, they call all the funeral home. They know them. They know them because they call all week long about whose bodies they have. One of these days, they're going to have to make that call because they're going to be at the funeral home. That's called being preoccupied.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not so preoccupied that I'm calling the funeral home every day. But I do check the obituary because a lot of times people have died that I know that I didn't even know they had died. And I feel shame about it. So we don't want to be preoccupied with events surrounding my death. Okay, go ahead. Searches for reason for the loss. No, it's my fault. Well, if I hadn't done this and if I hadn't done that, if I'd just, my mind told me not to do this and my mind told me not to do that. Honey, let me tell you something. Your mind can tell you whatever it wants to tell you, but that's not going to stop someone from dying.
Okay?
It's just not. And sometimes we beat ourselves up with guilt because death is out of our hands. Now, the only time you probably need to feel guilty is if you murder somebody, and that takes on a whole different situation. But if somebody gets in the car with me and we have an accident and they get killed, I feel bad about it. I do. I feel terrible about it. But I can't allow myself to get so guilt-ridden that I can't function. Right? Because they made a choice to get in the car with me, right?
Yeah.
I know somebody, right? Now, I'm talking some real stuff, y'all, because people do that. Well, I think I feel responsible because they had another role. If I hadn't told them, come on, ride with me to Dallas, they got killed, but I lived. Now, I'm feeling guilty, Brother Deborah, because I feel like I should have been the one died, and they the one should have been alive. But that ain't your decision to make. That's a decision that God made.
Amen.
So don't beat yourself up. I'm telling you, this happened. I was talking to some people just a few days ago that said it wasn't right that I lived and they died. Well, you're going to have to take that up, not with the insurance company. You're not going to have to take that up with the person that was in the other car to hit y'all. Y'all going to have to take that up with God because he made that decision as to who was going to live and as to who was going to die. Okay? So that's his decision. Sometimes with the result, it makes no sense. Sometimes people try to rationalize to no avail. Well, listen, there's no rationale that you can apply when it comes to dying. God made the decision. He knows the number. He knows the days of our being. He already knows how many more days Lawrence got.
Amen.
Y'all ever seen some of these clocks where they have a countdown clock?
Mm-hmm.
25 hours to the Super Bowl or 5 days and just count. Listen, I don't like them kind of clocks.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like them. I don't need a countdown. God is doing the countdown.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to know when I'm dying. I don't want to know that. I don't want to know. Because it's going to change the whole way I think. It's going to change the way where I go. It's going to change a whole lot of things. So I just, whenever the Lord gets ready, I'm going to stay ready. Hello, somebody. And that's another thing. Get ready. If you ain't ready, get ready.
Amen.
Get your bag. Well, no, you want to get your bag back. Just get ready. No, wait. In either place, it don't matter whether you're going to heaven or hell, you ain't going to need nothing. You ain't going to need no overnight bag. You ain't going to need no toothpaste and no toothbrush. You ain't going to need no shaving because if you're going to hell, all your hair is going to burn. You want to work, women, you want to worry about mascara and hair products and glow. Because if you go to hell, you're going to have a glow. It's going to blow all of it out.
Amen.
So don't look for reasons why. The Bible said it is appointed to all men to die. That's why. That's the reason why. It has been appointed from the beginning of time, when you came out of your mama's womb, that you was on your way to death.
All of us are on our way to death. I was born 19, matter of fact, I was born 1960, May the 1st. I got a birthday coming up. Same Sunday I have my anniversary, it'll be my birthday. What a great birthday present.
Amen.
If I'm living, right?
Amen.
I'll be 62. 62 years old, 62 years ago, I was in my mama's womb. She carried me for 9 months. When I was conceived in her womb, the countdown of my death began at that time.
Amen.
I don't know, I'm not in no hurry. I'm not asking the Lord to just keep on, I'm not asking him to take me. I want to stay here as long as I can.
Amen.
I ain't in no hurry to go. Hello, somebody. Let me just go ahead and say it. We'll speak with broken English. I ain't in no hurry to go. Excuse me, Sister Davis and all your teachers. I'm sorry for that broken English, but it's broken English, but it's good communication. I ain't ready to go. I still got a whole lot of living.
Amen.
I got to do. I got grandkids. I need to stay here long enough to see them bounce the ball and throw the football and hit the baseball bat and cheer. I'm praying God let me live long enough and be in good enough health so I can say, go, baby.
Amen.
Let Pawpaw go, baby.
Amen.
Okay. So search for reason for law. Just be like Job. The Lord give it.
Lord,
take it away. Bless it. Be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Okay, that's it. The next one. Dwells on mistakes. Okay. Real or you can imagine. See, sometimes the devil will play with your mind. He'll have you on a guilt trip and you'll start taking drugs. You'll start doing alcohol. We see it all the time. To try to anesthetize. That word anesthetize means dull the pain. So, well, Mr. McMill, that he or she made with the deceased. Listen, when I die, when you die, ain't no need to talk about what we could have done or what we should have done. It's over now. See, if you love your mother, your father, your brother, your sister, if you're in a quarrel with your brother, mother, whatever, you need to fix that now. Because when he gets put in that casket, there is no negotiating. Right? And I see people come to the casket, and they be negotiating. Brother, I'm sorry I did this to you. Sister, I'm sorry. I didn't mean that. Well, it's too late now because you're negotiating, but there's no one to renegotiate with you. So guess what? You need to do whatever it is. And you already know. I don't have to tell nobody. Everybody know their own situation. Man, ain't nobody been, because it ain't none of my business. But I'm telling you, if you don't get it straightened out before they leave, you're going to be on a guilt trip the rest of your life. And you don't want to be that, because it might cause you to lose, you might have to go to some kind of institution and get some mental help. So he or she is made with the deceased, okay? So if you and brother had an argument last night, now let's say, my mother she never went to college. She never had any formal education on that level. But she always taught us never go to bed mad at each other.
Yeah.
That's wisdom.
Yeah.
You'd be surprised how many husbands and wives go to bed mad at each other. How many children go to bed mad at their parents. And then when they die, mama, I'm sorry. That movie I watched every so often, that movie called Imitation of Life. And, while it might have been fictional, it had a real life meaning to it.
Yeah.
This child was a wayward child, and she just kept giving her mama trouble, and then finally mama died. And she just laid out on the casket, and it's too late now. Mama died with a broken heart. Okay, so we don't want to do that. Hit that next bullet. Feel guilty. That's the devil. Let me tell you something. Guilty. We feel guilty. And let me say this. Especially if you've had somebody sick, you've done all you could. Okay, you were there. You nurtured them. You fed them. Clean them, wash them. My wife is going through that right now. She's got a mother in the nursing home, and she's got a grandmother at home in a hospital bed. And she runs from the nursing home to the hospital bed. Just about soon, she came out and signed the doctor. And this is what she does every day. Okay. So when it's all said and done, she don't have anything. I tell her all the time, you've done, listen, if grandmama passed, if your mom passed, you have done all you could. You ran yourself ragged. Because a lot of times when she go to bed, she's so tired. And I, as I try to be a good husband, I try, you know, some men don't like to do it. I try to help wash. I try to do a little bitty things. I try to help, you know, but she's such a perfectionist. If I wash, she's suddenly going to take clothes back and rewash them. Because she got, what is it, PDF, or what is it called?
OCD.
OCD.
PDF.
But the part about it, what I'm talking about is relevant to this, is that when she, when they close their eyes, you don't have to feel guilty.
Amen.
Because you did all you can. And when you do all you can, you don't have to feel guilty about anything, right? It's the people that don't do what they're supposed to do. And I ain't going to be bashful about it. Who come out, who wait till mama gets sick and she can die, won't come see her, won't come see daddy. But the minute they die, well, mama died. Oh, I'll be there an hour. Where's mama checking account at? I know that she used to keep money in her checking account. Where's her checkbook at? Where's her rings at? Mama said I could have her shoes. She probably would have gave it to you before she died, but you never came to see her.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's what the old folk did back in the day, is that whenever they called, they knew they were close to their dad. They said, baby, you probably heard me say this again. They said, baby, take that chair on home with you. Mom, no, I can't do that. Girl, take that chair on home. Because mama knows if I give it to you now, it ain't going to be no fuss later on because I gave it to you while I was alive. That's called wisdom. So you don't have to feel guilty for the loss. Next one. Feel alone and distance from others. Called antisocial behavior. Disconnect. You don't never want to disconnect from your support network. If I pull this car from the wall, the power's gonna go off. Because there ain't no power. So you never want to disconnect from your network because you never know. You need support. When you're grieving, if there's ever time you need support, you need some support. When pastor's grieving, the strongest pastor is, I'm gonna need a support network around me. All right? That's why I'm doing everything I can to support you. So then when my time comes, I want y'all to rally around me.
Amen.
Oh, y'all didn't say that. Y'all didn't say what? Y'all just looked at me when I said, let me get in the center of this thing so y'all can see me again. When I'm going through my grief, I'm rallying around you. You call me, I'm going to rally around you. Amen. When I'm going through my grief, I'm going to be looking to see who's there.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to be looking and I'm going to be booking. Brother Mac, when we say, okay, Brother Mac was here today. He came by and spent a couple of hours with me. I ain't seen that old day, but she didn't come by. All right, so we feel alone and distance, right? Never disconnect, because that's the devil's oldest trick, is to isolate us, okay? Mm-hmm. To isolate us. And then we're going to talking crazy about, you know, God didn't love me, God don't care for me, where was God, all that kind of crazy stuff. You don't think the devil will play mind? When Jesus was in the wilderness, he came to Jesus. So if he'll come to Jesus, sure, come a little alone. But I don't have near the power of Jesus here. Right? I'm not near the man. I'll never be the man. I'm trying to become something like him, but I'll never obtain it in this life. I'm doing the best I can, but I'm not him. So if he'll try him at his lonely hour, he'll certainly try me.
Amen.
And he'll certainly try you. Because the devil ain't scared of you.
Amen.
Some of y'all think that he is, but he's not.
Amen.
You can make all them faces at him, and he's not intimidated one little iota about your facial expression. You know, some people try to intimidate. They, you know, they got a certain look, and they look at you, and they fix stare on you, and they're like, you know, That's why I shut my eyes when I preach a lot of time and teach, because I don't want to see all that, because I'm focused on Jesus, not how many looks you can give me. Because I'm going to do what I need to do regardless of how you look.
Amen.
Amen.
Feel alone and distance. Any distance happened to anybody that you know? Okay, come on.
Amen.
I'm letting you experience. Expresses anger, mad at everybody else because they're what they love. Well, that should have been me. God should have took my mama. Susie still got her mama and her dad. Well, that ain't Susie's fault. You can't be mad at the whole world because God decided to take your mom and dad. That was his decision. But you'd be surprised. People walk around and be jealous. You know, well, his mother lived to be 94. You know, my mom was just as good as her. Why didn't she have to die at 48? I don't know. So if you got any questions about it, you don't need to ask me about it. You need to talk to the Lord about it because he's the one made the decision to take your mother.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah. So don't be angry. Because let me tell you something. Anger and envy. First of all, let's deal with anger. Anger will destroy you.
Amen.
Yes, it will. It'll make you sick before you get sick. It caused you not to live long. You know, there's a lot of people walk around angry. I read a story today, right here in the state of Texas, this man got into it, they got into it about a dog. Some of y'all might have read that. And one man had told another man, because the dog was just roaming the neighborhood, should have been on a leash, but he wasn't. So the man said, the next time that dog steps in my yard, I'm gonna kill it. So what happened was, the little girl had heard and went back and told her dad that the man said so. He come out there and kicked the man, and while the man was bent over, he took a gun and shot the man in the stomach and killed him over a dog. Over a dog, because guess what? He was angry. Right? Last night, I was on my way to Kentucky. This is a real life story. And I don't know what's wrong with the people that drive it. I put my signal light on and I turned, and the man blew it. Now, can I tell you the true version of the young woman that gave you? Do y'all want me to change it up? Do y'all want the true version? Well, here's the true version. He blew at me. Okay, I'm going up in the driveway. I stopped. I blew back. He blew at me again. I blew back. I'm just talking about anger now. Oh, just that quick. I got mad because I'm thinking, I ain't done nothing but turn. I put my signal light on. So I kind of stopped the car and said, well, okay, I just need to back and kind of go on down the road. Let's see if we can meet him at the light. See how angry? Come on, y'all. Listen, I'm trying to help you because you've been there.
Amen.
And I know you're a Christian. That didn't change at all. I got angry for a moment. But then I thought about it out there with my child. You know what? This thing could have gone terribly wrong. Because if I'd have backed up, went down that road, who knows what would have happened next? Especially if I'd have had a gun. Come on, y'all. Let's talk some real talk. I'm talking about being angry. When you get angry, that's why they call it insanity. Because you lose your mind for a moment or two. Anger is not good. Being envious of somebody is not good. Because envious leads to jealousy. Jealousy leads to destruction. When people are jealous of you, they seek to destroy you. And nobody has no reason to be jealous of. Nobody sitting here tonight has a reason to be jealous of nobody. Or what they wear, what they have, what they kind of job they have. I ain't jealous of nobody. Because the same God bless you can bless me too. And especially if I don't go to work, don't be jealous of somebody who worked all their life to get what they got and you sat down on your duff and did nothing.
Amen.
You would eat steak and they would eat pork and beans. Amen. Which I love. I had some the other night. I love it. It's a poor man beans. I was raised on pork and beans. So you don't want jealousy in seeing others with their loved ones. Okay, we don't want that. Don't get mad at other people because God allowed them to live longer. Okay? Longevity, that's God's decision. Okay? And let me tell you something. You can be all so right and live so holy, still not live as long as some people who are not holy.
That's right.
Amen.
Psalms 37, I think, or 131, I keep getting them mixed up. One says, fret not for evildoers. Hello. For they shall soon be dealt with, right? Some people say, well, God, why did you take my mama and my daddy? They were Christian people. They went to church every Sunday. They loved the preacher. They loved the church. They paid their tithe. They did right. They didn't do nothing but just do right thing. And you took them, and yet Mr. Bob over here don't ever go to church. He cusses, he drinks, he do everything, and that rascal's still around. And if you be honest with yourself, you said it. You might not have said it to nobody but yourself. You be wondering, why do, you know, some pastor be said, why did you take Sister So-and-so? She was my best member. And you left so-and-so, and that was my worst member. You could at least took that one and left the good one. But we are not God.
Amen.
And so we don't make the decision. I'm glad I don't make that decision of who lives and dies.
Amen.
Because everybody I didn't like probably would be dead. Come on, y'all, let's be honest.
All right, Pastor.
You got to listen to me. You probably got to listen to me. Don't let it fall out of your pocket now. So we expect anger here and see another one.
Amen.
So glad God is in control.
Amen.
All right, let's go. We're going to finish this thing up here. Some of us continue to talk about let's get that next bullet. Reaching the acceptance state. At some point, you got to reach the acceptance state. You got to do as Job said. In all of my appointed time, I'm going to wait till my chain comes. I can't do nothing to undo it. All I have to do, because part of my healing, and everybody wants to heal, right? Nobody wants to walk around with emotional sores, because it's not healthy. So part of my healing is being able to reach a point where I accept what God has done.
Amen.
Right? I've got to tell myself, God, you are in control, and I accept the decision that you made. Now, we do it all the time. It may not be with them. We do. Decisions are made about us all the time, and we accept it, right? And we go to court, they make a decision, and guess what do? You accept it, right? Because there ain't nothing you can do about it, right? Now, you can go on and on, but it ain't helping. So we reach acceptance, and we adjust to the laws. Does not mean that all the pain is over. We got to be able to get to a point to move forward.
Amen.
Somebody said move forward.
Move forward.
Because let me tell you something. Even after life, death, even after death, life goes on.
Amen.
Because when death occurred, TU Electric, Cherokee County, or whoever you got for your electricity bill, when they find out somebody died, they don't stop. That meter don't stop.
Amen.
And when come time to pay, you either going to pay or they're going to cut it off. Because life goes on. Work goes on. Business goes on. Nothing stops when people die, right? So guess what? You got to make some kind of adjustment, especially if you got a bunch of bills. You know, that's why I advise people get some insurance so you at least have some money to kind of take a day or two off and be able to grieve properly. But when you're trying to bury somebody and ain't got no money, guess what? You can't take no time because you got to try to get that money together, because if you don't get that money together, I'm going to tell you what they're going to do with that mortuary. They're going to put that body on ice and going to take it to the cooling tank down there. That's what Mr. Francis said they do. They got a place where they carry bodies and they keep them cool. Because it's a business.
Amen.
And you can say whatever you want. That's cruel. But guess what? They've been burnt so many times. Mm-hmm. By people saying, we're going to pay. And then they make all these promises. And soon as John get in the ground, guess what? I ain't got to worry about it now because he's in the ground. They can't dig him up. So you got to get to that. You got to adjust to the law. It does not mean, I'm not saying that the pain is over, because the pain never goes away.
Amen.
Okay? How many of y'all ever had toothaches back in the day? Anybody ever had, you know, before you was able to go to the dentist, you know, I know some of us are bougie now, we go to the dentist.
Right.
And everything. We got a PPO plan, and we go get our dentures redone. But back in the day, that was a time when we didn't have all of that. And we get toothache, and we had a little medicine called Red Cross.
Mm-hmm.
It was in a little white bottle about like this, and a little Red Cross on it. And you take it, and it burned like heck. Hello, somebody. And then you put it on your little spot. Now, your toothache never went away.
Mm-hmm.
All that toothache medicine did was just dull the pain temporarily. It was a temporary fix.
Mm-hmm.
I wish I had somebody, right?
Mm-hmm.
We take that cotton, especially if we had a cavity. Come on, sit. Come on, talk to me, real talk. We had a hole in our tooth. You know, you take that, you put that Red Cross in, put that cotton down in it. Hello, somebody. And you could get some sleep at least for that night. But in the morning, that pain was back.
Amen.
And some of y'all won't admit y'all took Red Cross. Y'all might have some at the house now. We done went from Red Cross to Oregel now. That's crazy. No Oregel. You know that little stuff? There's a little clear you take it and rub the gum with it. Hello. Don't mean the pain is over. Accepting don't mean the pain. All it does is help you to deal with the pain.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Okay. All right. Let's go. Grieve with someone who was close to include losing the future you expected with. You know, we were going to do this. Me and my wife got a lot of plans. At some point, y'all, I don't want to scare nobody. At some point, I'm going to retire from pastoring. I've been doing this for 50 years. This is all I ever done in my life. Ever since I've been 16 years old, I've been pastoring and preaching. I don't preach till I die. At some point, John Devereaux, I'm going to stop pastoring.
Yes,
and I'm going to head for the hills, head for the woods. I'm going to give me one of the old funny looking fishing hats. Hello, somebody. And head for the hills. You know what I'm saying? We make plans. But God unplanned. That's why the Bible tells us to take no thought for tomorrow. Right? Don't talk about what we're going to do on tomorrow, because we don't never know if tomorrow is coming.
It's not promised.
We have to say, I'm going to do this if it's the Lord's will.
Amen.
Right? Because I don't know in the next 6 hours what's going to happen to Lord's. I hope I'll be in bed in the next 6 hours, but there's no guarantee. An ambulance may come to the house, and y'all might hear my passing, amen? Because we don't know, right? We make plans for the future, but God holds the future. And if it ain't in God's future, it won't become a reality in our future. Y'all still ain't said it. Come out 20 years from now, I call the Social Security office. Look at me putting my business and all in the. I call the Social Security office. The lady called me back. They said, "Okay, sir, we got all the ins and outs." She said, "Well, on June you can look. You're gonna get this amount. Blah blah blah." And I got off that phone. I was overwhelmed. Nobody was overwhelmed, not because of the money, but I never thought I would live to see the day when I would talk to somebody at the Social Security Administration about even getting a check.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? Because I could have easily died a long time ago. And I still ain't got the check yet. So I might need to, I already say if it's the Lord's will, because I might not get. But I did ask them, if I die before I get my check, will my wife get my back check? Because they always running them out behind. They said, "We ain't never had nobody ask that question." Well, if I die in July and she ain't got her May paper, will she eventually get it? They said, "Well, I don't know. I have to go check." Yeah. So don't make no plans. You know, we plan, but God, I'm planning.
Amen.
All right, go ahead. This must also be mourned. Go ahead. The sense of loss can last for decades.
Amen.
Decades. Now, I'm going to show you what I'm talking about. For example, years after parents die, the bereaved may be reminded of the parent's absence at an event he or she would have been to attend.
Mm-hmm.
Some people say, "I can't go back in the church because mama used to sit here. And every time I come back to church, I see mama's not sitting there." You're going to have to get over that.
Amen.
That's what's going to happen. You're going to miss your salvation. Mama already secured her. Okay, she gone to heaven. Okay, and you saying, "I can't go back in the church because it's too painful for me to see that front row and mama's not supposed to be there." Mama's supposed to be there. Well, mama's gone to glory. And at some point, you have to come to rationalize and say, "Listen, you know, I got to do something." I had a friend, Jackie Heron. I had a good friend of mine, and he died, got killed in a car wreck. And his wife told me, she said, "Oh, I'll never drive another Ford." And I went through a whole lot of process with her. And I said, "Well, the Ford didn't kill her. The man that was drunk driving another car killed him."
Yeah.
So I'm saying, you see how we attach things? You know, "I can't go back to New Jerusalem because that's where mama went. And it just hurt me so bad." Well, you got to break the ice at some point.
Amen.
Because you got to go back. You got to go to church somewhere. Right? So, you know, Christmas, you know, and I hate to see it because I see people in so much pain. My mama died around Christmas. Dad died around Christmas. My brother died at Easter. So now, every time Easter comes, I have to deal with the pain. It's almost like it's all been played out over and over again. At some point, you got to ask God to give you the resilience and the strength to be able to deal with the reality. Because if it don't, it'll ruin you. You won't be able to go nowhere. You won't be able to do nothing. You won't be able to travel. You know, you feel guilty and all this kind of thing. You just can't. You just got to get beyond that, okay? This can bring back strong emotions, strong, okay? And then mourning, yet another part of the loss. That's it. Now hit it again. Okay. If y'all don't know who that is, that's me. that's Pastor Brian. Okay. Because my memory is not as good, so I prepared a statement for the end of this. First of all, I want to thank you for listening to my presentation. Hit the next bullet. It has been my sincere hope and prayer that this presentation in its full, as it will, be a blessing to you. I hope that
amen.
Everybody
amen.
Has received a blessing amen. From this presentation. Amen. I hope it has been meaningful to you, and I hope it has been helpful. Okay. Certainly it has been helpful for me. Okay. Next. It is with great joy, I've done this, that I have had this opportunity to put this material together for your spiritual and emotional being.
Amen.
With sincere hope that someone will be made stronger and more resilient as a result of these lessons. Okay. I didn't just do this because I didn't have nothing else to do. You know, I had plenty else to do. I could have been out shopping. I could have been out buying shoes. Because I like to shop.
Me too.
Most people say, I don't know too many men that like to shop, but I do.
Me too.
Matter of fact, if it's the Lord's will, in the up and coming week, I'm going to Dallas. So I go to a couple of the malls so I can shop. See, my wife don't have one of them husbands. Don't. I let her do her shop. I sit there. And she said, what? She come out and she turn around. She said, how did that look? I said, girl, you looking cool. You go, girl. Yeah, it was my time. I come out and I said, how I look? So it is. But sincere, that you know, you've been made resilient. I hope there's something. You may not use it now, but your opportunity to use it will come.
Amen.
Remember what we told you. Okay? Go ahead. And then finally, may God bless you as you go through this journey called life. And so I hope that everybody has got something out of this presentation. Now, we've got a few more minutes left. Again, next on the 4th of May, which is that next? Is that next Wednesday? 2 weeks, okay. For the 4th day of May, which is Wednesday, we're going to extend our Bible study from 6 o'clock to 7:30. I've got two people coming. I've got the director of the chaplain services, and then I have the director of the Hospice of East Texas, and they're going to come and give their presentation. And I wasn't going to bring these people out here, but just I want them to have an ample amount of time, because that's only right. These are busy people. These are professional people. And I want them to have an opportunity to professionally present to you what they have to offer. And hopefully somebody will follow up. I'm going to get Sister Bell to put it on the radio. And we're going to put it on Facebook. We're going to invite people, whether they've been in these sessions or not. We're going to invite anybody that wants to come and be a part of that. We want to, because as I was telling the lady at hospice today, if one person is impacted by what we've done here this month and a half, and it has not been a waste of my time, it has not been a waste of your time. So I hope that you've been blessed by today. Anybody got any questions about any of the material that we've covered in this month and a half, three months, whatever? I don't even know how long has it been. It's been almost 2 months then, just about 2 months. So has anybody got any questions that pertains to this? I know you might have questions, but I'm talking about pertaining to this. Let me be more specific and more pointed. Is there anybody, and don't feel shy. Anybody want to give a testimony? Anybody want to have something to say? This, we got 15 minutes, and this is your opportunity.
Pastor.
Yes, ma'am.
And those folders, that's the material?
This is still some of the material that we have. Okay. This material. We will keep this material and this label on these. I prepared these and labeled. So there is material still left, and so we'll have this material available if you need it. Okay? And they'll probably bring the material with them, because she said they're going to set up a table. You know, if I don't have it, they'll be able to tell you where to get it and how to get it. And we understand that some of you are private, and so they'll have their business cards with you, with them, so that you can call them and set up appointments, because she told me she'd be more than willing to come to your house or wherever you want to meet her. This is how they operate, because they're in the business of helping people. And it don't make you be weak because you lost somebody and you need help. It does not weaken who you are, whether you're a pastor, a deacon, trustee, a community leader, song leader, whatever, choir member. Does not weaken who you are. Actually, it strengthens who you are, because you are at the point that you need help, and you realize it, and you acknowledge it, and you get the help that you need to become whole again. Because God does not want us to be operating at less than being whole. Death affects all of us, and it affects us all in unique ways. I don't know what I buried some brothers and sisters, but my mother's still living, and I pray that she lives forever. But that day is gonna come when she dies, and I can't tell you how I'm gonna be affected.
Amen.
I am gonna be grateful to God that He let her live, but then I am human. Mm-hmm. So if you come to the funeral and you see me crying, and I'll say, "Ooh, God, Pastor did all that teaching, he's just crying." I won't be crying as if I have no hope, but I may cry. Well, that's a natural action. So don't hold me to a higher standard than what you hold yourself to.
Amen.
Just get some cloth, clean that, and come over and help me blow my nose. Okay? Because that's where I'm going to need you, right? All right. Anybody got anything else about these lessons that we presented to you today? All over this course of time. Any questions? Has this been helpful? Let me ask questions. Y'all want to have any questions? Listen. I'm not going to, seriously, I'm not going to get mad. Don't just clap because I'm asking today. Has this been helpful for you? Any of this material, do you see where it might have already helped you, or do you see where it might can help you in the days to come? You know, it may not help you, but maybe you can share it with somebody else. Your neighbor, or your friend, or your loved one. This has been our hope, okay? Is to try to help you get through your life. Because I know that some of you all, and I'm going to be personal about this, that some of you all are dealing with some of this stuff right now. And you may not talk to nobody about it, but you are.
Amen.
And I hope that this in an indirect way, answer some of the queries. I'll put you in a position, I'll put you in line to get the information or to seek the right information that you need. Okay. It's out of love that I presented this lesson. And again, where you at? Sister, yeah, don't shake your head. Don't do that. Stand up. I know you don't want no credit. I know you don't want no notoriety. But this was the lady.
Amen.
That caught me by myself. She didn't try to embarrass me, didn't try to say, well, you're not doing your job. Now. She said, Pastor, would you? Because of COVID, and because people shut up, and because people are dealing with a whole lot of things, would you be willing to do a lesson on it? And I said, well, you know what? I think I'm overdue. So thank you, sister.
Amen.
Anybody else? Yes, sir, brother.
Well, it certainly helped me. I lost both my parents within 24 hours.
Okay.
It's helped me tremendously.
Okay. See, that's all the validation I need if it helped one person. So I reached my mission.
Amen.
My mission has been accomplished because it helped somebody.
Amen.
Amen.
And so, all right. Well, we're going to get out a little early tonight since we don't have no questions. I ain't got no problem with that, do you? Yes, sir. Do you have
no? Pastor Brown, he helped me a whole lot, too. I had a cruise set up for me and Glenda, and she passed away, and I had to go on a cruise by myself.
Yeah.
Where Frank and Beverly went, and I sat in the room, and I said, why are you sitting in this room by yourself? And I had a long talk with him. I said, baby, you gone, and ain't nothing I can do. I said, I got to let you go. And I let her go.
That's called.
And ever since then, I've been, you know, these have been hitting me a whole lot because it hurts. It's a whole lot of nice, you know, a lot of people really don't understand that they ain't lost nobody that you're real close to, because a lot of people said, well, you seen one, you seen them both, that's where it's supposed to be. And I went there, and this guy helped me a whole lot. And after that, I had a little Bible that my niece bought me, has her ash in it. And I walked in the Bahamas, unscrewed it, and just sprinkled it everywhere I went. Nobody saw me do it, nobody know what I was doing. And one white man, they was on the cruise with me, and he said, what's that bullet for? I said, that's not a bullet, I said, that's an urn. I said, my wife Asher was in it. I said, but she's not in there anymore.
Yeah.
He said, that is real neat. I had never seen that before. And so that's what I done. I, you know, I had to let her go, but it was hard. And I thank you for the lessons.
Yeah. You know, I do a lot of funerals. And I've done some funerals of some family members. And as many funerals as I've done, other folks, you know, I was affected by it and I cried. But it was also so different when I had to funeralize family members as opposed to church members. So people don't know. People see you smiling. They see you somewhat functional. But that's what they see when you're out in the public. What they don't see, what they don't know, what they don't hear is the tears that you shed when you're not around nobody. What they don't see is that you're restless all night trying to get the pillows right, trying to get in the right position because you can't sleep at night. And people reach the conclusion and then they say, well, you know, you try to get to the point where you do the acceptance so that you can move on. But even when you start moving on, then people start second guessing, well, he's moving too fast or she's moving too fast. But listen, everybody deals with things different.
Amen.
Now, again, my wife, we've been married, if we lived to 28th of May, we would be married for 39 years. I don't know what I'm gonna do if something happens to her, because she's my everything. She's my all in all. When I can't find my keys, she know where they are. When I can't find my phone, she takes that extra step and look. I'm just wondering, my boy, it might be I lost my wedding ring today, and she found it, you know? I don't know what I would do without her. My head, I'd be walking around, I'd be like the headless horseman, walking on foot, but I'm out. So we don't know how it's gonna fit. So the thing I tell everybody, I'm gonna close this, we're gonna get out of here, is make the best of what you have.
Amen.
Live your life to the fullest. If you got a wife, cherish her. If you got a husband, cherish. Don't let nobody tell you that you're doing too much for your wife, and don't let nobody tell you that you're doing too much for your husband. That's your husband, that's your wife. If you got a girlfriend, because some people might have that, you know, there's nothing wrong with that. Okay? Do the best you can, live life at the fullest, so when it's all said and done, you did, you made the best of every day.
Amen.
Yes, ma'am.
And I know, you know, it's a different, and I know everybody knows, it's a different feeling when you're seeing somebody die.
Right.
Rather than being in an accident.
Right.
Or whatever.
Right.
So, and you said, if mama's not sitting over there, now, and for me,
right.
When my dad died, we were
which,
not.
By the way, was a preacher. Her dad was a preacher. Did y'all know her dad was a preacher? Mm-hmm. Some of y'all didn't know that. Her dad was a preacher. Dad was a preacher. So if she ever give me any trouble, you know what I'm gonna throw on her? Your daddy was a preacher, and you ought to know better. Go ahead.
But anyway,
see what she say anyway.
My brother found him unconscious, and he never came back. So the hardest thing for us was after the funeral,
right,
is to go that first step going back into his house.
In his house.
And when we went to his church, it was the same thing, although it was still weeks or months after that.
Right.
So, and I grieve different from my siblings.
Right, everyone.
At the funeral, my sister decided we are going to sing. And I told them no. My sister next to me slapped me and told me to get up. I got up and I sung, but I didn't go, I didn't walk back to my seat. But they had to take me out. But it's just the way a person, we grieve differently.
Right.
So, and as well as the other, I really appreciate being able to see and to hear the presentation. Thank God.
Amen. We get ready to wrap up. Spencer Montgomery. You know Spencer? You know Spencer?
That's mom.
Yeah.
That's mom.
I was there when his, when Elder Henry's wife took her last breath. Mm-hmm. And if you've never experienced it, it's something you'll never forget.
Amen.
To actually see somebody take that last, she put out this large noise, and it's like a grunt I had never heard before. And so, death, it's real.
Amen.
All right, we're going to pray? Let's pray. Yes, sir.
Okay, so make the pastor, trustee, we're going to be in a few minutes after.
And we won't have male courts in person tonight. I gotta meet with the trustee staff. We got some stuff we gotta get taken care of. So me and y'all can go home for tonight. Okay. Lord, we thank you now.
Yeah.
I wanna thank you for this receptive, informative, and this ready audience.
Yes.
Who have wholeheartedly accepted this presentation. They came Wednesday after Wednesday to engage themselves as they listen to me present this stuff. I pray now, God, that they have been tuned now, that they have been equipped so that they can go now and they can minister to others, because it ain't just about ministering to this group, but it's about being able to minister to others, that they might minister to others, that we all will be made whole. Thank you for the challenge. Thank you for the challenge that was given to me to do this. Thank you for my response. Now, Father God, we pray that lives would have been changed, that emotions would have been made better, and that people are more resilient than they've ever been. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Now, may the grace of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with us henceforth, now, and forever. You're all dismissed.
go in peace and serve the Lord.